So I want to welcome you all to TrainingRite.com. We have been providing online training for software testing courses. And as you can see from our website, TrainingRite.com, we have been doing a lot of courses in the past. And this time we bring you a new course. This is a Ruby Cucumber course. Now, for those of you folks, again, who have taken any online training and have used the GoToWebinar software, then you don't have any challenges because it's going to be pretty straightforward the way you're going to be attending this training. Every Saturdays and Sundays, you're going to be logging on, and then you'll have a control panel onto your right side on the top, and that's how you would be interacting with us. This will be an interactive session, meaning that if you have any questions at any given time, feel free to ask me those questions. Right now, I have muted you, so any given time, if you need to ask me a question, you can put it in the chat panel, or you could raise your hand, which will flag next to your name, and then I will finish my thought, and then I will address your question. Now, as far as this training is concerned, it is going to be 8 sessions. We're going to be meeting on Saturdays and Sundays, and it'll be 2-hour each session. So this is going to run for about 4 weeks. As you see, the cost of the course is about $499. Now, if that is the cost if you take it as a single course. If you try to package it, we got a bunch of things up here, as you can see, different packages. There's a 6-course package. There is a 12-course package. So you can, let's say, for the sake of understanding it a little better and easy math, this is 12 courses, 12 months, and $1,200. So that is going to come down as $100 per course. So the same course which we are sending it for $500 will be yours for $100. Okay. Now that we have done that sales pitch, let us move on and see as what we will be covering as a part of this course. This is an excellent course. Not that I am saying it, but the industry is slowly but surely moving towards BDD testing, which is behavior driven testing. So the course is going to be totally tuned towards how we do BDD testing. Now, as automated testers, you should be knowing some programming language. It doesn't matter what programming you know. If you have done any QTP, then you know Visual Basic scripting. If you have done Selenium, then you know Java, and if you have done any other tool, then you would know that particular programming, like C# or C programming if you have done load runner and stuff like that. In this course, we will be doing Ruby. I will be starting off pretty basic. Would be introducing you right from the beginning. We're gonna, you know, I will be very happy to take people who can even just spell Ruby, because that's where we're gonna start as a part of this course. Now, the course is going to be pretty intense in the sense that we will be climbing a steep cliff, sort of, in terms of the learning curve is going to be pretty steep. So in 8 sessions, we got to be covering a lot of stuff. So I will be keeping you guys on your toes with the assignments. We will be giving out like 8 assignments. Per session, there will be 1 assignment. And if you complete the assignments, you can pretty much call yourself as a well-versed guy when it comes to Ruby. Because let me quickly take you to dice.com and show you that there are tremendous opportunities today when it comes to Ruby and Cucumber. This course is going to help you in a big way, because as you can see, they are paying you big dollars when it comes to Ruby Cucumber, right? Because it's all about supply and demand. Unfortunately, there are not that many people out there who know anything about Cucumber and Ruby. So you guys could really be, you know, setting up the trend in here when it comes to like, you know, what needs to be known, because when you go there, you will probably be the one who would be guiding the rest of the team, because nobody has got any knowledge about how to do these kind of things. So you will be shining like a star, because we are going to cover a lot of stuff as a part of this course. Now, I don't want to just do the talking, because probably most of you guys who have taken a training with us in the past, you know how I cover stuff in terms of hands-on. It'll be about 98% hands-on, meaning that I will be doing stuff and not be doing much of talking except on day one session, where I have to lay out the plot, give you an idea of how we should be preparing the environment and stuff like that. Now, just to give you some idea of what is the requirement as far as this jobs in Ruby and Cucumber are concerned, you can go and pick any position. And these days, fortunately, unfortunately, there are a lot of positions in Ohio, but that is not necessarily the case on any given day, because you could find opportunities anywhere, you know, within the continental U.S. So let's say if we go and look into this, what is needed out of you? You are required to know Gherkin scripts. You should be well-versed in Gherkin. And I am going to take you right from the beginning when it comes to Gherkin, right? So we will be doing a lot of Gherkin. We'll be doing a lot of Ruby Cucumber, Ruby Gems, Watir. All of this is what we will be doing. So I have configured this. I have picked up the topics in such a way that when you get out of this course, just make your resume, float your resume. They're going to run after you. They're going to literally go on their knees and beg you to come and join their team because of the stuff that we'll be covering as a part of this course. I guarantee you, if you do the assignments, if you do the assignments, if you do the project work that I ask you to do, there is no looking back. The going rate right now, depending on how much of stuff you know, is somewhere around like 65 to 85, and in some extreme cases, they're even paying like $90. So it all depends, like, you know, how much of stuff you know. Okay, so how much of programming is required as a part of this course? Now, if you have done QTP, okay, good. If you have done Selenium, very good. If you have done SoapUI, you know, you are the guy, I guess. When it comes to Ruby and particularly Cucumber and Watir and Capybara and Calabash, all of these things require you to have a sane, a good amount of programming knowledge. But again, when they say about programming knowledge, again, you are not developing, you are not creating applications, you are going to be testing. So if you are going to be testing, then basically you need to know, you know, things like how you could be writing an automated script, right, in Ruby, right? You would be writing this script in Ruby. Now, Ruby is a programming language, right? So if you look into the other programming languages, Ruby is not going to be totally different. It is like any other programming language, but it has got its own taste, its own flavor. When you try to write certain things in Ruby, they are going to be slightly different than how you do it, let's say, as an example, in Java. But the concepts of object-oriented programming still are the same, meaning that in Ruby, you will be creating classes, right? We will be creating classes. We will be instantiating objects out of classes. So now we will go and introduce ourselves as what exactly is a class and what does a class have inside it in terms of properties or variables, instance variables, class variables, global variables. We're going to talk about the methods that you could be, or the functions that you could be creating as a part of that class. Now, when you instantiate an object out of that class, you know, how does that object call certain private and public methods inside the class? We will also be looking into a parent class and then a child class, something sort of like inheritance, right, which is a major part of object-oriented programming. So I'm going to talk to you and explain you what is the object-oriented programming concepts in terms of abstraction, in terms of data hiding, in terms of inheritance. Now, when you inherit a child class, when you try to call a child class and if it inherits from the base or the parent class, how does the whole thing work? How do you override certain things? So we'll be looking into the concepts of overloading and overriding. We will differentiate, we will distinguish between, how when you have to call a function within a child class, how you can override that and go into the parent class. So we'll be looking into constructors, how constructors can be overloaded. Now, talking about these things will make you like, wow, now this is going to be something which is not for me because I'm a tester, and this guy is literally talking about, you know, some serious topics of object-oriented programming. Now, trust me, if you will be a part of this course, I will make sure that you understand every little bit of it. Not only understand, because you will be implementing all of this, you would be doing this with your own hands when it comes to like doing your assignments. And if you do it like a couple of times, then you, of course, are going to get everything out of it, right? So that's the whole idea of giving you the assignments. That's the whole idea of making sure that you get it. So now Ruby is one part of it, right? And as the course has been designed, we will be talking about Ruby. In fact, I'm going to introduce you to Ruby today. And you will have enough of understanding of Ruby today that we will go and then create some of the scripts in Watir. Now, you would be saying, what is Watir, right? And why do we need to learn about Watir? All that I would be introducing you to just today. Now, when we say introduction, we will do some, talking about it to make you understand what it is. But more than the talking, I'm going to be giving you the materials as we usually do. So you will be seeing that. Hang on for a second. If I log into my own account, I should be able to show you the amount of stuff that you're going to be getting out of this course when you register for this course. I know there are a lot of folks who have taken unlimited training, so you don't have to worry about it. As soon as you decide that you want to go for this course, I'm going to be giving you all this material. Here it is. Now, this is our group, and there's so many boxes on my screen that it's no fun. Ruby Cucumber. Okay, just to give you an idea, we'll be introducing ourselves to Ruby, right? So I'm going to be walking you through and giving you as all the instructions, step-by-step instructions as how you could be implementing, Ruby, meaning that how you could be creating an environment on your machine so that you could execute Ruby scripts, right? So today I'm going to walk you through so that we create the environment, because it's critical to our learning. If you don't have the environment, on your own machine, how are you going to execute those scripts? Now, unlike QTP, where you just download the tool and write your scripts inside the tool, here it's not like that because it's open source. And believe it or not, even major companies, big companies who have tons of moolah, tons of money that they could be buying licensed tools, but even these big companies, they are trying to go and take the open source route, meaning you would be finding that these open source tools like Selenium and Ruby and using Cucumber Capybara and using Watir, this is catching like wildfire. And then very soon, this is going to become like the standard when it comes to testing. All right. So Now, there would be another way of learning this, where some companies who would be charging you tons of dollars, like $5,000 to train you, they might have their environment created on Amazon servers, right? Then you are logging in onto their environment, which has already been readily done, and you're just using their infrastructure. I mean, I could create that in no time, but you know, I want you to go through the process of creating the environment, because when you are going to join this company, whatever that company is, fill in the blank, you are going to be the person, the leader they will be looking up to, right? So you got to be knowing everything about this, right? How to set up the test beds, how to set up the complete environment. So that is what I am intending to do through this course, walking you through step by step so that the whole environment is set up. So today I'm going to be doing that for Ruby, which is the major part of it. But then once it is done, once you guys register for the course, then starting from the next classes, I'm going to be walking you through about the water, about your capybara, about cucumber, and we're going to be talking about certain tools that you have to download. Today I'm going to be starting you off with Notepad, but very soon we will be using NetBeans, we'll be using RubyMine. So I'm going to be walking you through the setting up of all that as a part of this course. All right, so while we begin to do all of this, these things, I mean, I'm not so keen about reading stuff, you know, putting something up there and then reading it for you. So I don't want to do that. You know, I would rather want you, because that would make it as a boring class where I have some PowerPoint and I'm just reading it off that. I totally believe that, you know, you have to have a hands-on experience. But that shouldn't take away anything about sharing the content, you know, theory content with you. So that is why I prepared all this documentation, which I will be giving it to you. And I expect you to go through and then read these things. There's a lot of, you know, good points which I'm trying to make in here. So I want you to go ahead and then read these things, wherein I talk about, you know, BDD, what is a behavior-driven development, and how as a tester we got to be knowing all of these things. So I am talking about these things, right? So I want you to read that. But when the time is right, I'm going to go and, you know, walk you through even, you know, certain theoretical things which I need to explain you, I would do that. All right. For now, I'm going to give you an overview or a big picture, right? Something from 40,000 feet above about this whole thing. What is Ruby Cucumber Watir Capybara web automated testing? The idea here is about web automation testing. We have to be doing web automation testing. So there are applications, and we have to go and then test that application. So the applications can be your client server applications, your web applications, and your mobile applications, right? Now, Ruby, by writing scripts in Ruby using, let's say, Cucumber framework, using Watir, using Capybara, using something called Calabash, you can be doing the testing for different environments, meaning that for different platforms, for different kind of applications, something that runs on mobile, we could be doing that if you bring in something called a Calabash API that would help you to run Android, you know, testing. Now, if you want to do a web testing, then we could be bringing in even Selenium in here, even though you're not really needed to do that, but we could be bringing in Selenium. But we will not be coding using the Selenium library, using the Selenium API. Selenium API would be used under the hood. Under the hood, meaning that on top, you just need to know Ruby, and you need to know either Watir, or you need to know Capybara. So you would say that, what the heck is, I understand about Ruby being a programming language. What is Cucumber? What is Watir? What is Capybara? What are these things, right? Why do I really need to know these things? Now, Watir and Capybara, these are sort of like DSLs, right? Domain specific language. So this is more like English way of doing your testing. English way of doing your testing. And what exactly you meant by English way of doing testing, that's what I'm going to be talking about. And we will today, I will use Watir today, and I'll show you how to do the testing. And I will come to the point today on day one, up to a point that we could be doing an data-driven testing using Ruby on day one. But I'm going to stop there. I'm not going to show you the data-driven testing on day one, but we're going to pick up there on day two. So to make the long story short, the whole idea about getting into this course is to do automated testing for web applications. And if time permits, I'm going to show you for mobile applications as well, but no promises, because you have to have a good background about mobile devices and all that for you to get into that. And that is the reason we have it as a separate course, which is right here. For those of you folks who would be interested, you should be looking into that particular course. But in here, I'm gonna try in this Ruby course to introduce you to mobile testing, but we will see. No promises, but we will see. But the rest of the course, which is for the web application testing, is what I intended to do as a part of this course. Okay, so if you are going to do web application testing, let us do some comparisons between the other tools which are available. So the other tools which are available for us today is what? We have QTP as a tool which will help you, right? And we have Selenium as a tool which will help you. So why Ruby? The reason we want to use Ruby is because of the fact that we will be working with, particularly in using Agile, right? So the Agile methodology requires you to collaborate with different sets of people. Now, who are these different sets of people? You would be working with the stakeholders, the owners of the application. You will be working with the developers. You'll be working with business analysts. Now, you would say that, how is it different? I have worked with them in the past, right? I mean, so how is it different now? The way it is different is going to be, you will be writing the scripts. Believe it or not, you'll be writing the scripts in English. Yes. You would say, I thought we wrote some scripts in English as well. How come, you know, this time it is going to be different? The way this time it is going to be different is because, in the past, we have tested off of, after the fact, meaning that after the application, even little code of the application was created. Let's say, we were testing here when the form was created, right? So we have written our test scripts after the fact, right? Now, we are going to drive the creation of the software, meaning that we will be first in line to interact with the owners of the application, meaning that the owners of the applications, they are going to write the script, right? When I say script, meaning in English, as an English story, they'll say that when I log in or when I visit TrainingRite and when I click on the new customer link, I should be able to enter first name, last name, email address, password, and when I click on submit, it should give me a message like customer added successfully. Right? So they are saying this to you in English, right? So you will take their English statements and you will convert the English statements into a test, into a Ruby test. And your developer is going to take your test, which you will create in Ruby, and he or she is going to be writing the script for that or creating the code for that. They are going to design and create. So understand that in the past, the way the testing used to happen was Okay, business analysts and the developers and all of those guys, they get together, and then you have the specs, and they create all that. And then once they create it, you come and then you test it, right? Now you will create the automated scripts. You will come up with the job or the work for the programmers. You will come up with what the programmers has to do after interacting with your stakeholders. I mean, it's not that the developers would not be there in those meetings. They will be there in those meetings, but you have to be creating those tests, and then you would be giving it to the developers, and then the developers would be actually building the whatever that test case requires. And then while they build it, when they test it, because according to your test, you are saying that this is what they should happen. So while they build it, they would be doing their unit testing. And once it is done, then it will come to us, and then we can do our regular testing the way we used to do it. So, I mean, when you hear it, it sounds like, I'm not really getting it. So once you start seeing it, it will, everything will sink in. Okay, so to begin with, I'm going to start off with writing, or how can I write before when we don't have the environment? So we got to have the environment, right? So we will be creating the environment, hang on for a second, somebody is looking for a link here. Okay. Too late. I cannot give the link right now because we are in the middle of the session. Okay. All right. So we have to go, and then we have to prepare the environment. So in order to prepare the environment, first of all, in a nutshell, let us go and understand what we are going to do. We are going to create automated scripts, and these scripts are going to be created in Ruby. So they have to create it and get executed on our own machine. So in order to do that, I have to go and prepare the environment. So here is the step-by-step document for you to do that. So let me take you into the Ruby. And if you look into it, now your Ruby is an object-oriented programming, right? But it is not going to be compiled like a C program, like a Java, that you are compiling it, right? It's a scripted language, right? So it's there's no compilation that is happening, right? So it is so you have to basically write that script in such a way that this can get executed on any platform. So what kind of platforms are we talking about? We are trying to run it on Windows, we are trying to run it on Unix or Linux, or we want to try to run it into Mac or any other environment like that. So this course is basically about Windows. So I want you to understand. So if you want to run it on, let's say, Mac machines, there are certain things which are going to be different. I will not be covering that, but you will have enough knowledge after walking, after going through what I explain you about Windows, that you could just go on the internet and then download the tools for Mac. Because the tools are going to be different, and some of the syntax are going to be different, but the main core concepts remains the same. All right, first of all, I gotta go and then download Ruby on my machine. So if I go in here, and if I bring my command prompt, and if I wanna make sure if Ruby is there on my machine or not, right? So I would say Ruby hyphen version, and that it is telling me that, okay, Ruby is installed, Ruby 1.9. So because it's already installed. So let's say make believe that Ruby was not installed. So I am make believe that this is 1R. So I just want to show you how it would look on your machine, what kind of command you would get on your machine. So let's say this is Ruby. So Ruby is not recognized as an internal or external command. So because that means that Ruby is not installed. Right. I hope you are getting the point why you should not be typing 2 R's. You should be typing 1 R. I cannot show you this, what it says in here, because I have already downloaded and installed Ruby. But so if this is Ruby hyphen version and Ruby is not installed, this is what you're going to see there. All right. Okay. So if Ruby is not installed, how are you going to go and then install that? Okay, this is the area where you're going to go and then download Ruby. So if I click on that and take you to download Ruby, here it is, right? So we can go and download Ruby from here. Now, depending on if you are downloading the Ruby, which can run on major platforms like Unix, Linux, and OS and Windows and all that. Now, in our case, we are particularly looking to download it for Windows, right? So if you're looking for downloading on Windows, now, there are a couple of ways of doing that. You could be downloading one thing at a time and running it, and then go and then download another thing at a time and run that. Or else, there is something called a, if you are doing it for Windows, there is something called a Ruby install. So Ruby installer, what it does is it gives you everything you need to set up a full Ruby environment on Windows, right? So I guess that's a good thing, right? So that's what we should be doing. We click on that. It takes me to the Ruby installer, right? Okay, now here, when it comes to Ruby, there are different versions of Ruby, all right? The latest version, which just came out about like a month ago, is Ruby 2.0. Right now, then you have Ruby 1.9.3, then you have Ruby 1.8.7. Now, I am not going to worry about 1.8.7. That's an older one, right? So majority of the work that I have done is on 1.9.3. Now, you can go and then download Ruby 2.0, but since it just came out, there are going to be some challenges here and there if certain things doesn't work and all that. So what I would suggest is, and this is how you know, major corporation, the policy of the major corporations is, if something new comes out, which is the version N, you always want to go with N minus 1 or N minus 2 for stability. Because N minus 1, in this case, if N, this is the 2.0, is the latest version, N minus 1 would be 1.9.3. So that is kind of like the stabler of all. So that's why, yeah, we want to go with that, right? So that's what you could go and then you could install, all right? So let me quickly walk you through the installation without spending crazy time in here. So what it is going to do when you install is, because I have already installed it. In fact, these are the screen dumps from my installation. So that's what I'm showing you here. So as soon as you download that, and it's in a zip file, and double click on that, it extracts and gives you the installer. Maybe it is too small for your eyes at this time, but when you, after this session, even though you are an unlimited student, you are at, you know, 12 course, 3 course, 6 course, whatever you are, and already registered student, I don't know if you want to take this course or not, only because you know, you don't know what you're getting into. So today's session is all about what you are getting into, right? What is coming. So after watching today's session, if you want to enroll, just shoot us an email at trainingrite@gmail.com, and then we will put you into all of these groups. So you will have access to everything what you're seeing in here, right? All the material will be given to you. All the videos will be given to you. We have, you know, many videos that I have created, so that I will give it to you already. So just let us know about it if you want to go. That way you have the control of making it bigger, smaller, whatever. Right now you're just looking into what is the font of it right now. So if you look into starting that, it is basically going and installing it. It will, you double click on that, and then says that, okay, what language you want it in. So you did mention that you want it in English, and then it's basically you have to agree to the licensing. And once you agree to the licensing, this is what it is. It, now the point here where I'm going to pause and show you a little bit here is, when you are installing it, It wants to create a folder called Ruby 193. Why 193? Because we have downloaded 193. So it will create a folder Ruby 193. So if I take you into my C drive, and if I take you to here, so this is Ruby 193, right? So if you see here, now I have not created in that folder. Ruby 193. I have created everything inside the Ruby training, inside the Ruby training, and inside the Ruby training, I have created this Ruby 193 and I have dumped everything in there. Now, in your case, it doesn't matter. Just take the default settings, which it is offering you. So if it is offering you Ruby 193, so be it. Go with that. Now, the things here, don't worry about the first option, even though I selected, don't worry about the first option, but do select the second and the third option. So what are the second and the third option? Now, if you look into the second option is adding the Ruby executables to your path. Adding the Ruby executables to your path. What do you mean by that? What I mean by that is, once Ruby is installed, you're going to go into the DOS prompt and you're going to be running those commands in there. If you create any Ruby files and if you want to execute those Ruby files, you should be able to run it from anywhere, right? So if you want to run it from anywhere, then the settings of Ruby should be, the path of where Ruby had been installed should be set into your environment variables, right? Now, again, for those of you folks who are coming from Selenium or coming from like Java and all that, you already know what I'm talking about. But for the rest of you, I will just take you and show you what it does though. So when you go in here, start, and when you go into the control panel, and if you go into your own system, this is your system here, when you click on the system, it takes you to the advanced system settings. Click on that and this box will pop up, and this is telling you about your environment variables. Now let me click and take you into the environment variables. In the environment variables here, you could, the system will automatically, go and say where it is installed in the path here. See the path here? Path, it will tell where it is installed, provided you have this check. Add Ruby executables to path. Add Ruby executables to path. So that will point it, point where it is installing into the environment variables, into this path, right? So if I take you into in here, somewhere here, it would have told where it had installed. See in here, I have installed it. Okay, so here, my path is in the, because I do Ruby on Rails also, so I installed in that. So it is pointing to Rails installer, Ruby 1.9.3 bin, that's where it had installed. In your case, it will say C, Ruby 1.9.3 bin. So it will be in the C drive for you. All right, okay, so that is basically the settings, which the second one will do. Now for the third one, associate .rb and .rbw files with this Ruby installation. What it means by that is, when you create a Ruby code, the file will end with an extension of rb, right? So how do you create those Ruby files? I mean, we can go into Notepad and I could create it in Notepad. Notepad is a free tool, right? So it's a poor man's tool, as many people they call it, because it can do the basic stuff. But if you want to do something more than that, then you have to download some other tools. Now for Selenium scripts, we use Eclipse, right? We use Eclipse. Now, can we use Eclipse for Ruby scripting? Sure, you can use that. But there are some better tools which are available, better IDEs that are available. And that is, we will be using something called NetBeans, right? So I'll be using NetBeans. So we have to download and install NetBeans and all that. There is a process of doing that downloading and that, again, I have kept it. I have kept it in here. See here, I don't know if you can see in the background here, NetBeans documentation. So that will show you as how to download and all that. So that I will be covering tomorrow using the IDE. So today we will use, let's say, Notepad, or we use Notepad++ that we can download and use. So when you when you write some code in Groovy, if I write some code in Groovy in here, right? So my code would be, let's say, welcome to TrainingRite.com, Ruby Cucumber plus, right? Okay, and here I say puts, and let me take the same thing, right, and copy paste and do that. And so this is a simple one line. This is like in Java, we do system.out.println and all that. Here we in Ruby we use puts for that. All right. So now if I want to run it, first of all, file, save as. How do I save it as? Right? How do I save it as? So if I go in here, just for the heck of it, I will create a new folder, and this new folder is, let's say, TrainingRite Ruby plus. Let's say, okay? TrainingRite Ruby plus, and in this I am going to save this. I'm going to save this. So how do I save it? In order to save, first of all, you go into all files, and here you give it a name, whatever name it is, right? So let's say welcome Ruby .rb. So when you do welcome Ruby .rb, so this rb is associated with Ruby. And how does it associated it with Ruby? Because here we are saying that while we are downloading the Ruby code to create the environment, we are setting it up. We are saying that all .rb files should execute with the Ruby installation. So that was the meaning of that. So let me just quickly put it. Now, because you are creating it using Notepad, I always prefer to put it in the double quote. When you do it in the double quote, it is not going to append the TXT extension. Otherwise, you'll have TXT extensions. So this is welcome ruby.rb that I saved inside that folder. So if I follow everything in here, right, after I install, if I want to check when the installation completes, please open command prompt and type. Now, if the command prompt was already open, let's say if you did this before, and it said that Ruby is not recognized, and then you went downloaded and everything, and then you install it, and then if you still come back and then do this, it might still say the same. So always close it and then reopen it, and now you give the command. So the command that you are going to give is ruby-version. Right? And when you do that, whatever was installed, Ruby 1.9.3, that is what basically you are going to see in here. Once you see that is installed, right? If you do a basic script, that is, I just want to check if the Ruby files are associated with or not, right? This is what you can do. You can navigate yourself to that folder where we have created that. So cd.dot will take me back to my C prompt. And I would say cd TrainingRite, and what was that TrainingRite? Ruby class or something like that. Ruby class. Right. There it is. So in here I created something called welcome Ruby, right? .rb. Right? Now notice what happens. I typed welcome ruby.rb and hit enter. Now it is opening up. It is opening up that file, right? Did it run that file? Now notice that I never got that message, which is welcome to Ruby. So what you do here is you just don't say welcome Ruby. You say Ruby. I want you to run this file, and the name of the file is welcome Ruby or whatever that file is. You would say that. So the word Ruby should come first. Space. Welcome ruby.rb, and then once you do that, it gives you welcome to TrainingRite.com Ruby Cucumber class. Now, we are not going to say welcome to TrainingRite. We will have lot of code in that lot of code in that class, right? Or rather in that Ruby file. So what kind of code can go in there? That's basically what we are going to learn as a part of this course. Now, if you see, I just walk you through downloading Ruby, installing Ruby on your machine, running the very first file of Ruby. Okay, let's look into, is Notepad the only tool which you should be using? Notepad, as I said, is the poor man's code. It is better if you download Notepad++. So you go to the internet and you say download, let's say Google, and we say download Notepad++, right? Okay, so that brings us to this site, and I could go ahead and then I could download my Notepad++, right? So see here, this is the Notepad++ installer. It will take about less than a minute for you to download it. And once you download Notepad++, try to have like a shortcut onto your desktop. So here is my shortcut on my desktop. So this is Notepad++, right? So I'm just going to double click on Notepad++. Now, what you see here is it's a slightly better tool in the sense that it will give you some colored way of because Notepad, it's not visually rich. It's not visually rich compared to Notepad++. It is, you know, much better than Notepad in the sense that you have different colors in here. You could work with, you know, different types of files and all that. So what I'm going to do here is go and then write my first script in Ruby. Now, you would say that the first script in Ruby, I have absolutely no idea of Ruby. What kind of script are we going to write in here? My introduction to you is I will introduce you to the language through our testing, meaning that many you know, people have different ways of learning. But if you have attended my any other course in the past, like whether you have taken SoapUI course where we have Groovy scripting, whether we have used my Selenium where we are doing Java. So I prefer not to go and learn everything of Java first before going and then doing our testing. I would like you to introduce you to what it is, what it can do, and then while doing our testing, we will be learning Ruby. So what are the things that are needed as far as learning Ruby is concerned? Now, again, if you have heard me in the past through any other courses, then this would be like something, a repetition of that. But you need to know about variables, right? Any language, you need to know how to create variables, how to assign values to the variables, how to use variables in your code is basically what you have to do. So when it comes to variables, how to create variables, right? And then how to assign values to variables, how to assign values to variables in Ruby, right? And how to put variables to use in our automated scripts, right? So that's about our variables. Here you have, again, arrays, right? So we would be knowing about arrays. One more thing you have here is hashes, right? So I'm going to be talking about what hashes are. It's nothing but you know, storing of multiple types of data in the name value pairs. So you have name value key pairs, right? That we will be using in terms of hashes. Now there are different things that we could be doing with the arrays and hashes, like sorting them as any order, copying one array into the other, and putting these hashes or arrays to use in our scripting where we are doing some automated testing with data driven. And if the data is not coming from Excel, and if the data is sitting in arrays or in hashes, how do you read those hashes? How do you read those arrays? How do you pass, again, data that is stored inside the arrays into an automated script and all that? So all that is what we will be doing. Again, if you're coming I'm repeating myself for the umpteenth time, that if you're coming from Selenium and if you're coming from any other, then you have seen me writing those scripts in there. Again, you will see the same I would be doing in here. So when the time is right, I'm going to be introducing you to arrays and hashes and all that. Now, more importantly, the most important thing here is, which we have not done in any of the previous classes, is creating classes, right? So here, that's why I'm putting it in bold or in uppercase. We will be learning as how to create classes, because we have to be creating some classes in here, and we will not only just be creating classes, we will be our own classes, we will be instantiating objects from our own classes, instantiating objects. Now, if you have attended the other classes or other courses with me, I talked about instantiating object from the class, but the instantiation of the object is from a predefined class, like a Selenium class, right? So that Selenium class has been written by somebody else, right? So we are just instantiating an object from that class and then using the methods of those objects to do something. Selenium open this, Selenium type this, Selenium do this, Selenium do that. Here, we are not going to do anything like that. We will be creating our own classes in Ruby because of the fact that we have to be doing certain things which require us to create those classes ourselves and store the data inside the classes and run some of the methods of those classes. That is why it is important that you should be learning it. And in fact, if you are going to be a Ruby Cucumber tester, automated tester, you would be working really close with your developers, right? Much more closer than Selenium test engineers or QTP test engineers, because you are literally going to create the test cases that will become something, a template that a developer would be following, meaning that you will be telling him or her what to do through your test. Because you, the position of an automated tester has been much more elevated using BDD, behavioral development, because the testers now, they will be working with the owners, the stakeholders, owners of the app, and then as they dictate things in English, you will be converting them into automated test cases, which will feed the developer their jobs of creating the software. So that the developer would, I think I did mention it to you, that they are the ones who are creating, but you are telling them by working with the stakeholders as what they will be creating, right? So their unit testing is basically being driven by the way the software is going to behave, and you have to have a complete understanding of how the software is going to behave, because that functionality will be given to the whole team in English, and you have to convert that English into Gherkin style, and those Gherkin style would be in Cucumber, and that would be feeding into Ruby. So at this time, it's all like theory, or like, I don't know what he's talking about. I mean, you know, it's just like babbling all along. But very soon, like, once we start to see, once I give you enough of Ruby that we cover these things, I will quickly take you into BDD. Even though I will be taking you into web automated testing. We will be doing some web automated testing, but it is not BDD. So BDD comes with Cucumber. So that probably we're going to be starting off like on the fourth day, after we learn a good amount of, or maybe third day, after we learn good amount of Ruby along with Watir. That's the focus for the first 2 days, and starting from the third day onwards, we're going to be jumping into Cucumber, and then we'll be doing a lot of stuff in there. before that, you have to have certain idea of these things. That's why I walk you through today about downloading and all that. Okay. Now that we have some idea of what we are doing in terms of Ruby, Ruby is the language, right? Ruby is the language which you will be using to do what? To do your web automation testing. But if Java was the language that we were using in Selenium, right? Java was the language and the tool was Eclipse and we were writing the code in Java, but we were using Selenium, right? We were using Selenium, right? Here, we are using the tool is going to be, let's say, Notepad++ or the IDE. If you really want a better tool, that would be either this or later on I'm going to show you RubyMine. RubyMine is basically a commercial tool, meaning that you have to buy it. You have to buy it to use it. Now there's a 30-day evaluation period. I am actually talking with them to give you guys like an discount, like a student discount. So even though the tool is like $100+, they are giving it for $29 as an academic, promotion. But that is for universities, that is for technical schools and all that. So I am trying to have a word with these guys so that they can give the same to my students. Let's see. I mean, if that happens, it happens. Otherwise, at least it's going to run for 30 days, that should give you enough of practice of RubyMine. And we will introduce you. I'll start to show you about RubyMine probably like in the fifth or sixth class, because that way you should have some enough time to practice with it even after the course ends, because, that has 30 days. Or else, I mean, you could go and buy it, $100+, I guess. You could buy it. Meanwhile, who knows, if they start to offer it to us for $29, there's no, I think, better deal than getting it for like under $30. So you should buy that. Anyway, so that's the IDE. I don't understand the specific reason to use RubyScript to test web apps if you can achieve the same thing with them. No, yeah, Selenium is one way of doing it. Selenium is one way of doing it. Ruby is another way of doing it. So it's not like you have to be using Ruby. Now, Ruby is preferred in scenarios where you have to do BDD, behavior-driven development. Then Ruby is preferred. Otherwise, if you're doing just a simple web automation testing, then you're fine with Selenium. So the question here was, can you please clarify? I do not understand the specific reason to use RubyScript to test the web apps if we can achieve the same thing with Selenium JavaScript. Now, I'm not saying that if you have to get to work, you have to have both, Mercedes and BMW. I mean, you can leave an impact, you can leave your impression having any one of the two cars, right? Either you buy, so it is your choice, right? So if a company decides to do their automated testing using Ruby, then that's where we are going in there. Now, as a Ruby, Cucumber and Capybara and that kind of a tester. Now, if somebody is looking for Selenium, then you are using Selenium. Now, where Ruby shines is in BDD, because in BDD you cannot, or I shouldn't say you cannot, but it's like a long shot if you want to do it just using Selenium. You can use Selenium to do BDD as well, but it would be long shot. So try without going into the details on day one, hour one, BDD. Think about it as, if you have somebody who has absolutely zero knowledge of technical, jargon or technical, buzzwords or anything to do technical, he or she has zero knowledge of it. And then they still want to explain to the technical guys that how the application should be built. So they have to. They cannot say that, you know what, go and design a class in Java and have these methods in it and make sure that you do over. They have no clue of overloading, overriding. That they have no clue. So they have to talk to developers and testers and anybody in simple, plain English. Simple, plain English. And that is exactly what BDD is. What should be the behavior while you are developing the application? That application development should be based on the behavior the behavior rather should be based on what they give it to us in English. So they would be saying that when I go to a website, you know, then I will find that there is a username and password. You know, so when you put, given you go to a website, when you log in, then you should see welcome message. So it's all based on given, when, then. So this is how they will talk to us in English. And then we will take that. Yeah, we'll take that user story and then we will convert that into using what is called the step definitions. And that is a part of wherein we come in and we take the English user story and we convert that into your step definition, which basically would be fed to the developer, and then he would be creating functionality based on that. So both of them are open source. Selenium is open source. Ruby is the open source, both of them. So today what we will do is we are going nowhere closer to BDD. I'm not going to talk about, because there are many, many, many moving parts in here. So if I start to bring in everything, then it becomes like a spaghetti, and it becomes like, it'll be so convoluted, it'll be so much of a mess that you would be, it would be difficult for you to untangle out of that web. So what I am going to do is slowly, one thing at a time, I'm gonna introduce you to the whole big picture. So for today, what I am showing you that might bring a thought that, like what exactly Madhuri, she asked, is what the heck? I mean, why are we doing this? Why don't we go with Selenium? Sure, you go with Selenium, right? But this is there. Now, whatever is coming in the next, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 classes, it'll be very difficult for Selenium to do it. So the easy way to do it is using Ruby and Cucumber. So that's why we have to do it. And particularly when you are talking about BDD, Cucumber right now is the king of BDD. There's nothing that is coming close to Cucumber as far as doing that. So I am not introducing you to BDD today. I do not want to do that. My whole intent of today is to give you enough idea of Ruby that, okay, Ruby will be used for automation. So far, we have downloaded Ruby, right, on our machine. We ran a very, very simple script, which is just spitting out some text, because that's what we told it to do. Okay, next thing is we want to do, let's say, some automation. Forget about BDD, forget about Cucumber, forget that you heard the word Cucumber, right? So what else Ruby can do? Why do we want to learn Ruby? What can Ruby do? After downloading this, the next thing we want to do is we want to use Ruby for web automation, right? We want to use Ruby for web automation. Now, if you want to use Ruby for automation testing, Ruby by itself cannot do automation testing. So you need to install something more to do the automation testing. And what is that something more? That something more can be, for today, there is something called Watir, right? W-A-T-I-R. Now, you might say, what is this Watir thing, right? What is Watir? So the word Watir, it is pronounced as water, as we drink water, but it stands for Web Automated Testing in Ruby. Watir, W-A-T-I-R, is web to me dead testing in Ruby. Okay, now if you see, that is water. How is it water? This is W, this is A, this is T, and this is I, and this is water. So what does water do, right? Water is nothing but it's a powerful, powerful tool. It is growing fast, so fast that, you know, when you have to do web automated testing using Ruby, people jump onto water. And there is another competition that is coming up right now, and that is Capybara, right? And so I'm not going to talk about Capybara, at least not today. So today, let's focus only on water. So water, like a lot of companies, like when we went into that DICE, you noticed that they asked you for, do you know water? So today, we will know everything about water. Everything about water is what we will be knowing today, right? Now, in the next class, I'll be done with water because I will create a data-driven framework using water as the thing in tomorrow's class. So we'll be done with water. Then we're going to move on to Capybara. We will move on to Cucumber. We'll move on to RSpec. We'll move on to Calabash. So there's so many things. So we will start and finish. Now, you might be saying that, how can you finish such a huge, big topic in an hour or two? Because there's nothing there. People make it such a, it's such a hype, right? Nothing there. I mean, how many different ways are there to skin a cat? Now, you could always come back and say that, I am very creative. I'm going to skin it from the tail, not from the head. Well, you could do that, right? But then there are so many ways that you could learn water, and because there's not much in there, right? And that's what we'll be doing today. So water is nothing but it's a web automated testing in Ruby. If you have to do web automated testing in Ruby, is water the only way? No, because I said we'll be learning Capybara soon, but today it is water, right? So if you want to control, right, something on a browser, if you want to type in the browser, if you want to click on a button in Ruby, can Ruby do it by itself? Answer, no. Ruby has to rely on another thing called water. So where do I get water, right? Where do I get water? How can I make Ruby and water talk? So basically what happens is Ruby can be extended. Ruby as itself is a programming language. It is supposed to do for loop, this loop, that loop, if statement, this and that. That's what it is supposed to do. It is when it was created in the beginning, maybe it was not created only for testing. So testing came on later on, right? So if you want to expand the behavior of Ruby, if you want to add more and more to Ruby, there is something called a gem concept of Ruby gem. So we have to install, so they call this water or any extension to Ruby to make Ruby much more scalable so that it can do many other things, gems should be installed. So gem as in G-E-M, like a very expensive thing, right? So it's a Ruby gem because Ruby is, you know what Ruby is, diamond and platinum and then Ruby. It's like a, is it a metal? It's not a metal. So what is Ruby? Like, I mean, how would you say that in English? Forget about programming. Ruby is what? Ruby is what in English? And you guys should be known. Like, it's an expensive what? Gold is a metal. Platinum is a metal. Is Ruby a metal? Right? What is Ruby? Come on. You guys can do it. Thomas, you can do it, Tom. So tell me, what is Ruby? Forget about programming. Forget about automated testing. Ruby as an expensive, which you want to stone it is. Rahil says it's a stone. All right. Beautiful. Now, if you just say stone, right, you're like, you don't want to give stones to your spouse, to your partner, right? You want to give a ruby, right? So likewise, if you want to make this ruby much more bigger, better to do web automated testing, you have to install the, you have to add the water gem, right? So that brings us to an interesting topic about what are Ruby gems and how do you interact with Ruby gems. So if you go back to the same document which I was talking about here, this is I introduce you to Notepad++, right? We can type, I mean, you can type whatever you want to type in Notepad. So where is that script which we had typed before? So if I go in here, if I go into TrainingRite Ruby class, right? So if I open this, and if I take this and copy it, and if I put it into, this is your Notepad++, right? And this is welcome to the Ruby class, and I'll say that, okay, let me do this. Let's say I want to create a variable in here, right? Variable is trainer equals, right? On the fly, right? I'm not even using def, I'm not even using string, I'm not, on the fly, I'm using trainer as a variable, and I assign something into it. So let's say I assign a value called that in the trainer, right? Now, do you have to end with a semicolon? Not needed. So I have declared a variable called trainer, and we have this value into it. Now I'm spitting out something onto where I say welcome to TrainingRite Ruby class, and I want to your trainer is. Now I want to take the value from this. Right? Now, one of the ways we used to do in the past was use the concatenation operator and then use that, right? Now, what Ruby does is, this is where Ruby kind of like shines a little bit, is within the double quotes, right, if you want to find out the value of a variable, then you start off with a hash sign and this curly braces, and inside the curly braces, you put the value of trainer in there, right? So if you see, now we said welcome to let us save this back into TrainingRite Ruby class, and in here I will call it let's say welcome trainer, or forget about welcome, this trainer.rb. So what we are learning in here is, now it doesn't matter if you have txt down here or all files or whatever, as long as you enclose them in the double quotes, it doesn't matter. So I will be creating a trainer.ruby class. So what we have done is we have created from here. Now the question is, can you execute this from here? Unfortunately, you cannot execute from here. For that, you have to go to the IDE. And the IDE would be RubyMine. RubyMine is what we have to use, this JetBrains RubyMine. That is what we have to use, which we'll come to it later. So for now, we have this file, which is trainer.ruby, and I have to execute that. So I come in here, and I will say, hey Ruby, I want you to go and run trainer.rb and hit enter. Now as you can see, welcome to TrainingRite Ruby Cucumber, your trainer is, and as you can see, it took the value from here. So it took the value, your trainer is, it took the value from here, and it gave you the value of that. So what we have seen so far is how to create a simple script, how to use a variable, and how to take the value from a variable, pass it to here, right? Okay, so far, talking about the things that you need to know, this, okay. So later on, we'll be looking into arrays, hashes, creating a class and all that as we move on. All right. So now coming back to, we were doing the automated testing. For automated testing, we said we have to have the water, right? Now, how do you get water into Ruby, right? And how do you make these two things work? For that, if you go back in here, so I did finish this text editor Notepad. We can, if you're using Mac, you can use the text mat, or you can use these kind of tools, right? So we'll be talking about that. So this is a welcome to training. I did that. Now let me just skip this part and then jump on to, let me just skip this and jump in here to that part. All right. Now I'm not skipping anything. I will be showing you about one of the features of Ruby called IRB, Interactive Ruby. I'll come to that in a minute. But let me get in here. Installing Ruby gems. we have to install RubyGems. So RubyGems is nothing but it's a package management system, right? In other words, you can say that it's a way to bundle and distribute and install other related code, right? So all that is like come in the form of gems, right? So Watir is some other code which you want to bundle along with your Ruby code. So if you want to use some other code, that some other code is called a gem, and you could bring that gem into your environment. So you have to go and bring that gem into your environment. So the way you're going to be bringing your gem into your environment is, first of all, gem itself is something that comes as a part of your Ruby installation. So you, before, what version of Ruby are we using right now? 1.9.3. So before 1.9.3, even gem needs to be installed. So right now with 1.9.3, gem is already there as a part of that. So if I go and do a gem version, it would tell me what version of gem I'm using, 1.8.20. So this comes, you don't even have to worry about it today. Gem is an integral part of it, gem software. So what does gem as an package management system, it does? It allows you to download the other gems like Watir, like Cucumber, like Capybara, like RSpec and all that, because your environment in Ruby as itself is bare bones. It cannot do all of those other things. So your environment needs to see those gems installed. So how do you install a gem in here? So to install a gem, you can just say gem install, and whatever gem you need to install. In our case, we have to go and install the Watir, right? That's what we want to install. So it is gem install Watir, right? Now, if I do that, it is going to take like a second or two and come back and say that, one gem install or because I already have it installed on my machine. So you won't be seeing much in here, right? Unlike if I did it, as you can see in here, it is already installed. So you won't see, unlike what you're seeing here. If you see here, right, let's see that there is lot of information in here. This is the first time if you do it. In my case, since it was done, so it says that two gems installed, and this is installing the documentation. It always does override and install the documentation and all that. And this will come to it in later. But it is installing that Watir. Now, you just don't need Watir, but you need something more. And that is called Watir along with everything else that is needed, all the dependencies of Watir as well. So here, we need to spend a little bit of time to make you understand how this thing works. And you just need it on day one. After that, you are all set. Basically, what happens here is you have, let me mix up my thing here if I can. I forgot to hook up my board, so probably I'm going to do it here in Notepad. Okay, so yeah, basically what happens here is I don't have a drawing board, sorry. So we have a tool which we'll be using, which is NetBeans, right? So I'll be using this NetBeans, right? For today, I'm using Notepad++ or Notepad, but very soon we'll be using NetBeans. And then very soon we'll also be using this RubyMine. So those are the tools, right? Those are the tools. So if I could go in here and show you, that's the tool wherein we'll be writing some code. So when you write the code in those tools, right, that code which you are writing is going to be Ruby code. Ruby have absolutely no understanding of how to do web automation testing. Like Java on its own does not have any understanding of how to do that. So we need something like Selenium to do that testing, right? And in Selenium, we have different flavors, like we have Selenium IDE or we have Selenium WebDriver and all that. So here, what happens is, here you, this is your tool. This is your tool that you will be using. And this tool can be any tool as we talked about. It can be your Notepad, or it can be your Notepad++, or it can be your whatever other tools we talked about, right? So this can be Notepad++, it can be your, right, Ruby Mine, it can be whatever. So we are writing some code. The code that I'm going to write is going to be all Ruby code. The intent here is, let's say for web automation, forget about Cucumber and all that. I'm not bringing in Cucumber at this time, right? The idea here is to do web automation. So these lines of code, they have to go and they have to perform something on the application here. The application is a web application to do something, right? So by itself, Ruby cannot do all that. Ruby cannot do. So we have to bring in here something called Watir, right? So we can do Watir, and we can also do, later on you will see, I will bring in something called Capybara, right? So we'll bring in Capybara. So it can do that. Now, so what is this Watir, or what is this Capybara? They are nothing but, they have some simple commands in there. Very simple commands. You won't believe, you have something like, if you want to visit a website, you would say visit, right? Visit. So the language that they try to do, visit, and then you will say, okay, where you want to visit and all that. And it takes you to that page, right? So the language which the Watir and Capybara, they are using, that language, DSL, domain specific language, that language is also very close to English, very close to English. So what it does is, they are trying to make it so easy so that when you are looking at this test case, it should be easy enough for you to understand, to a, even to a non-technical guy, it should be easy enough to understand that this is going to perform this particular test. So you say, visit this page and click on that. So you're not using anything technical. So this English statements which you are saying, like visit on it and click on this or type on this, that should go and perform whatever things that you need to perform. So even the Watir and Capybara, they need under the hood, inside they need some driver to perform these operations. Some driver to perform this. So in case of Capybara, there is something called a WebKit, W-E-B-K-I-T, WebKit, Capybara WebKit, which understands this English things, which say visit this website, click on that, and then it performs whatever it needs to perform. Or majority of the times what happens is, under the hood, this driver, now here is some secret which I'm sharing with you, even though superficial on the top, it is Watir which you are using, Capybara which you are using, which is nothing but an easy way of writing your commands to go and perform some action. But the actual performing of that action is done under the hood by making use of Selenium. Now you would say, what? It's a, what the heck? Why are you doing that? Why can't you just use Selenium right there? So Selenium is hidden from you. You don't have to worry about the Selenium. So you just will be using Watir. Watir internally would be using Selenium. Capybara internally would be using Selenium. It can, it is not the only way, but it can use Selenium under the hood, right? The other things they can use is WebKit, and they have their own proprietary way of doing that, but it can use. Now, what they are totally trying to do is, they are trying to make use of the people who are around, right, with these kind of knowledge, they are around, and meaning there's already a lot of Selenium, knowledgeable people out there, right? Not that you, literally, you need zero knowledge of Selenium to do web automated testing using Ruby, right? I'm just sharing with you the internal details of what is happening. Oh, superficial, on the top, it is like Ruby code, and Ruby would use Watir, and Watir would go and then do the testing in here. You don't need, you know, the knowledge of Selenium at all. But under the hood, Selenium can be used and will be used, and that's what we will be using, right? And we'll also be looking into the other ones like the WebKit and all that, but that's what it is. All right. Okay. So first of all, I need to download the Watir, and I downloaded Watir, right? Gem install Watir. Now, but Watir would be needing that web driver. Remember that web driver which I just told you? This web driver, Selenium web driver. So Watir needs that. So I should go and install Gem, right? Gem install Watir hyphen web driver, right? Hyphen web driver. So that's what we have to do, right? Let me just clear the screen, right? And see it here. Gem install. So I need Watir with the web driver. That's what I need. So once I do that, right? Now it will have my environment will have, because as it is showing you one gem install, because it's already installed on my machine, so it is not taking much of the time. It is just going ahead, and because I already did that. So here is the documentation of all that. So if you go one step down, here it is. So I'm showing you gem install Watir web driver, right? Now I'll talk about the bundler later on. So gem install, rake, bundler, yard, Watir web driver. This is like anything and everything, all dependencies would be bundled together. So you don't, for now, I'm going to, you know, take step by step and then and show you about the bundler and all that. Right now, you just need the gem install Watir web driver. So we do that. Now, this, when you do that, all the dependencies, including the Selenium web driver, gem, will also be installed. So if you have good eyes, right here where I am, where my mouse is right here, right here, this one, right? If you read this line, Selenium WebDriver 2.39 is getting installed, right? Getting installed. So that's what gets installed as a part of doing the WebDriver. Okay, now on your machine, when you do it, you would see. Right now, you did not see that because I already did it. I had to prepare to show it to you, so I already did it. So it says that successfully installed one gem installer and did not go. It did not pull all of this, but here I took the screenshot of when I was doing it a long time back. I took the screenshot of that, right? I mean, if I take you into my virtual machine and then show it to you, it will do all of this, but you will see it anyhow. I mean, when you do it on your own machine, you'll see it. So there's no point in like me showing that. Okay, so once you do that, now everything is ready now for you to. Now I skipped this one step where we need the RSpec, right? Gem install RSpec. Now and this RSpec is used for Ruby. Again, does not have a way, because Ruby is not the language used for software automated testing. Ruby is a programming language used for many other purposes. If you want Ruby to be used for testing, and in testing you have something called assertions and all that, so there is a gem out there called RSpec. This is used particularly for assertions and things like that. So we also need to install that gem install RSpec. So if you do gem install, and because we might have some assertions in our test, so that would go ahead and then install that. So gem install RSpec. So right now we have everything installed. We have everything installed, and we just need to write some script so that we could go ahead and then do some automated testing. Okay, here, whenever you need to update these gems, you could use something called gem update. This, if you give a particular name of that gem, it is going to update that particular gem. If you, let's say, give just the system, if you say the system, like gem update and system there, then it updates everything in the, all the gems in the system, right? So that's what it is going to do. Okay. Now, that's good. We have looked into preparing our machine right now. Now, let us go and look into doing some automation. So I'm going to go and create a simple script in here. That script that I'm going to create will do some automation. So I'm going to go in here, web file new, and this one. Now, whenever you write, you want to create some or instructions to yourself, like a comments. So the comments in Ruby are written with a pound sign, with a hash sign. Now, if you write anything in here, that is going to be a comment. It will not be executed. So I will write this thing that this script will open Firefox browser, right, and log in to the TrainingRite application, right? TrainingRite.net. So basically, this is my test case. So let us look into my test case and write our very first test case in Ruby and Watir. Okay, so let us look into the test case. So here I go. Here is my test case. I open up a browser. I go to TrainingRite.net. In TrainingRite.net, if you scroll down a little bit, over here, you have a login. You have a login, right? Returning new customers can log in using the formula. So if I have an account, my phone number, if I say 732-998-650, right? So that's my phone number. And I put some password, right? And I hit submit. I want to automate this. When I do that, now, before this class started, right, I cleaned up, I removed my account so that I can show you two things. I can show you that I don't have an account, because if I try to log in now, it will say that we are sorry, no matching profile found for the username and password combination. You know, if you forgot your password, retrieve it. If you did not, then go and then register it, right? So it is not there right now, not there. Now, just on my machine, just to show it to you, and you will have access to it. I'm going to give you access to it, you know, very soon. Behind the scenes, it goes and it registers the name onto our database. So if I go and pull up all my customers, if I do a select star from TrainingRite customers, right, and if I go and if I execute it, now notice that this is some table that I use for the testing. So if you see here, we have this is the person, Shweta, there is another one, Malika, right? So I am not there. 1 to 12, I'm not there, because it just cleaned up a lot of other records, so I'm not there. So what I'm going to do here is, I will, and this is what I'm going to show you, is your assignment. You don't know anything about it, but I'm giving you this assignment well in advance so that you can see what the assignment is. You will be going to this and keep this as your, let me put it in here in the chat. This is your link, right? This is your link, TrainingRite.net / TRGUI transactions / register.asps. You have to create an automated script using Ruby and Watir, right? So that when you enter these things, it should create a new account, right? Now, right now I'm doing a manual test. So I'm going to put my name in there, and I'm going to put my last name in there. And let's say I put TrainingRite, and this is what you are going to automate. I'm not going to show it to you for this one, but I'll show it to you the other one. That way you'll get an idea as how to do that. So we do a password and we do a password and home phone number, let's say 732-998-6650. Cell phone also, I'm going to put the same 732-998-6650. And I will say that this is Ruby class, right? Today it is Ruby Water. Okay, now if behind the scenes this uses a web service, this uses a web service, and in that web service is the code to create a new account by putting it into this database, right? Now you are doing the GUI testing using Selenium and Watir, so you have to come up how to do that, and you can only do it after I show you how to do it. For now, I am just giving you this as an assignment. You don't know how to do it, but I'll show it to you how to do it. So when I click on submit, right? So this is what. Now notice it said customer information added successfully. So if you are doing any assertions, on this page, you are looking for, if it went in successfully, you are looking for this thing. If it did not go successfully, then it would have not given you this one. So if you are looking for this text, let me just, that would be our assertion, right? Just keep that in mind. So coming back in here, did it add it in here? We have only 12 records, so I'm just going to go and run it and see if we have 13 now. We have more than 13. We have one more, right? So probably you guys have done it before I did it. So here is my two, right? 732998 that, and okay, so we have this as a password, right? So we have this as a password. I can tell you I did not do it with 1234. So somebody from you guys, you did it, right? So I did it with this password, so you might have done that. Okay, so we have this, right? Now let us go back and to this one and do the test. So if we log in now, if we log in with that, and password is that, and do that. Okay, with that password, right, with that username and password, I have this, I'm successfully logged in, right? Okay, so all this was manual testing. Now let us do the automation. For automation, we decided that we will be using Ruby and Watir. Okay, so did we prepare the environment? Yes, we prepared the environment. Now let us go in here and write your test case in here. This script will open Firefox, log into TrainingRite application, right? And now let us see how to do it. First line first, you would say require. Now you don't know if your environment is having the gems like web Watir web driver or not, right? So you will say, in case if it is not there, you want to have that. So you would say I want Ruby gems first, right? Let's say if you are running the older version, so you want to download Ruby gems, and then you would say require, and let's say your environment doesn't have Watir web driver, so you want to have that. So this require, this means that if the environment doesn't have it, go and then download it. What we did manually here, that's what it is going to do here in the script. Okay, very good. Now what I want to do here is, now watch me carefully, what I want to do here is I want to use an object, right? Whatever object is, let's say the browser object. So I will come up with browser as the object. I want to use an object, right? This object is coming from, this class, Watir, right? Did we install the Watir gem? Yes. So inside the Watir gem, inside the gem is nothing but it's just some software, right? So that is a Watir class. From that Watir class, I want to, this two dots means that you want to get this from the Watir library, from the Watir library, give me the browser class, give me the browser class. Now, browser.new means that you are going to get a browser as an object, browser as an object, right? So this browser is the class. From this class, you are creating an object. You can call this dog, right? Now, I don't want to call it a dog, right? I want to call it a browser. Now, you would say that, this little bit confusing, this browser and that browser. By the way, which browser it is? You said Firefox browser. Now, is it every time is Watir going to give you a Firefox browser? That's a good observation. I would say no. So you have to do this. You have to say Firefox. When you say, you gotta spell it right. When you say Firefox, right? It is from the Watir library, go to the browser class, instantiate that browser class, and while you're instantiating it, give me a Firefox. And that will be my browser. So can I call it my browser? Yeah, you can call it my browser. Why should I call it my browser? Can I call it Firefox Brow? Sure, call it Firefox Brow, right? Okay, just for the heck of it, we'll call it FF Brow, right? So FF Brow is going to be coming from this Watir main library. In there, there's a browser class. We instantiate that and we pass to the constructor the type of the object. So it is going to be a Firefox browser. Okay, now that I have the Firefox browser, I would say FF Brow, Firefox browser, right? Go to where? I say www.trainingrite.net website. All right. Okay. Now that's more than enough for me to do the testing, and I will come back and then at least test if this much of a script is running. Is it opening a browser? Yes, it is opening a browser. Is it going to trainingrite.net? Yes or no. Right. So based on that, if it does all that, then I'll come back and say, do this now. So this is, I would say, TrainingRite login test dot rb, right? Dot rb. So now I have to run it. So I bring it up. I am already in this TrainingRite. So I would say Ruby TrainingRite login test. What is that? Login test dot rb, right? Okay, let us see what it does. I hit enter. Now I wait. Now a browser should open up. A browser should open up. And if I move this a little bit, you see that a browser should open up. That should be a Firefox browser, right? And here it is, Firefox browser. Is it taking me to trainingrite.net? There it is. It takes me to trainingrite.net. Voila. It is following everything I tell it to do. And if you pay attention here in this area, let me just, it is under the hood, it is using the web driver, right? It is using the web driver under the hood, it is using that. Now, later on, I will show you how to use something else. For now, that's fine. Okay, very good. So it did whatever we told it to do, beautiful. Now, I will take it to the next step. What is the next step? Well, the next step was we basically wanted it to do certain things, right? Like, what do you want it to do? I thought we wanted to go and enter something in there and, username and password and all that, right? So that's what we want to do. And then once it does that, tomorrow we'll be looking into parameterizing it. So if you want it to go and type something in here, which is my phone number, my password, and click on this button, how would you do that? Now, what I am going to show you, you would say, this is something that I've already seen. I already know there's nothing new here because I know Selenium, this is what Selenium, we do it in Selenium. I would say, I appreciate that you know all of these things, right? And I am so thankful that because I like that kind of attitude where you are confident about these things, right? Now, day one, this is just the beginning. Now, we have another 7 more days to come, you can imagine what kind of stuff you'll be learning with, you know, so much of other things to cover, like cucumber, like capybara, like calabash, and RSpec, and, you know, doing so many things. So there is a lot to be dealt with as a part of this course. But to continue and finish off today's thing, I have to type something in here. The way I'm going to type something in here is if I know what this thing is. In order to know what this thing is, first of all, I got to make sure that I know this is an element on a page. This is an object on a page, or more precisely, this is a text field. This is a text field, right? So this is a text field. This is a text field, right? And this is a button, right? So if this is a text box, this is a text box. What is this text box? How can I tell, Watir, go in and then type 732-998-6650 here. How can I say that? So I need to know what it is. In order to know what it is, we have to, first of all, download from the internet something called a firebug and a firepath that will make me understand or rather make Watir and Ruby understand how to find out the name of this or the ID of this text box. So again, for those of you folks, now just for my understanding, if you can just tell me who from all of you guys know Selenium, so that that will help me to not go into the details of just say I know, you know, and type it back. That way I know that you know Selenium, so I don't really have to go into the details of showing you step by step as how to find out some attributes of this, right? So if you guys know, okay, I have only 4 guys in here, or 5 of you guys know. Okay, for the rest of you, in order to find out, you know, what this element is, you have to go to Google and you have to download. So just go to Google and download from here, download something called Firebug. What Firebug is, it's an add-on that goes and sits on top of Firefox and helps you to figure out what is the property of an element. So if you download that, if you go in here and if you download, yeah, notice here I it is grayed out because I already have it. So if you don't have it, there will be a green box. When you click on that, it will go and then it will install. To find out if it is installed or not, go under Tools, and you should see this Web Developer, and you should see this Firebug, and you should be able to open the Firebug, right? Okay, so go back to your application. So I will go back to my application here. Make believe that you have already installed the plugin. Installation of plugin should take about literally less than a minute. It shouldn't be taking more than a minute. It should take less than a minute. And you should install that plugin. And once you install the plugin, if you go under Tools, you should see this Web Developer. And you click on Firebug and open this. Click on that and it will be open. As you can see, it is open here, right? Okay, so I am seeing so many things in here like Firepath, cookies, net, this and that. You might not see Firepath, so that's not a problem. You can just click on this HTML. If you don't see Firepath, you can click on HTML. And now you want to find out some details about this object. The way you can find out the details about this object is click on this next to the bug. Click on this, and bring your mouse and let it rest here. And once it rests there, now notice here in the blue part here, it is saying that input ID equals txt phone. That means that this is the name of this text box is txt phone. So now I got to go and then write my script. And the way I'm going to write my script is I have to say, I want the Firefox browser, right? Firefox browser, after we said go to trainingrite.net, I want it to find a text field. I want it to find a text field. Notice here, dot text field. And in here, when it finds the text field, which text field it has to find? So you have to say colon ID, whose ID equals, and in the single quote, type txt form, right? Because that's what it was, txt form. So you are saying the way to identify this is, here, and the way to identify this is, let me just put it in a notepad so that you can see it in a big thing. So you would say Firefox dot text field colon ID equals and this greater sign and then that. That. Once you do that, you say dot set. Set. Set what? Give it a number, which is 732-998-6650. Right. Okay. Now I'm hard coding that value here. Tomorrow I will be creating some variables and we'll be enhancing the script. So this is what it is. All right. So if I go back into my code, here and do a dot set. Tomorrow I will increase the font of this so that it is bigger. Now the time is almost over, so let me quickly finish this. 732-998-6650. So that's the first line. Now, just for the heck of it, I'm going to save that, make sure that it is running. So I come in here and I do a same repeat that command. If you do an F3 or an up or down arrow, now it should do not only open the training, right, but it should also go to text phone and set that number in there, right, phone number in there. So let us see if it does that. After it does that, it becomes very simple for me because I need to know how to do the same thing for my so I'm gonna go in here and let's see if it does that. So okay, so there it is. As you can see here, it already put the 732-998-6650, right? Okay, so let me just go ahead and quickly finish that thing off. Time is almost over, so I will say ff brow, right, dot, this also is text field, and here I am going to do colon id, and tomorrow I'm going to show you the rest of the attributes that you can take. Now what is that? I don't know, so we got to go take this and do that and come over here, type that. This is txt password, so I'm going to take this txt password, come back in here and txt password single quote and do that dot set, and in the password I think in the password it was uppercase password, that, and while I'm here I'll do, because we want to go and click on this button. So let me just find out the attribute of the button. Click on that. Click on this button. And it is ID equals BTN submit. ID equals BTN submit. So I'm going to take that. And since it's a button, so I'm going to come back in here and say FF brow, Firefox browser dot, there is a button whose ID is, right? So colon ID. Now this time I can either go with ID, or if you see, there was one more attribute in here. The attribute in here is, if it is a button, you can also go with the value. See here, value equals submit. So let me just slightly change that, and then rather than using that, I'll say use an attribute whose value is going to be that. Value is going to be uppercase. I think it was submit. And on this one. We are not setting anything, we are clicking on that, so dot click. All right, okay, beautiful. So we did that. Now I come back in here and I do that and I run that, and hopefully it will be able to go ahead and then do that.
And after it does that, we have to go and do an assertion. The assertion would be, do you see something in there? Right? Okay, let's see. If you go down and enter that, enter password, click on that, and there it is. So it automatically got in there. All right. Okay, so if I have to do assertion, since I log in with this username, so I'm saying that somewhere in the page, if you find this, that means that it is successfully able to log in, right? So if it is not, then it is a failure, right? So we can write that. So it's already 4 o'clock, so we'll write that tomorrow and then do some data-driven testing tomorrow. All right, so that's basically what it is. So this is an introduction to today's class of automated testing. So in tomorrow's class, we will go ahead and then do a lot of stuff. So we started off today with me introducing you to build the environment in the form of Ruby. So you will be downloading Ruby, and after we download Ruby, we try to enhance that by putting the gem and by installing gems like Watir. I showed you and I talked to you about what is Watir, and then we integrated Ruby with Watir, and then we have written a simple script which basically would go and do a testing. The assignment for today, as I already told you, is as follows. You will go ahead and you will do the following. Here you will, I gave you the link also, right? So each one of you would go and do this, and think, I think this is absolutely not a problem. There's nothing that we covered today that you can use and be able to create this automated scripting. So you should be fine with this part today, all right? Okay, so that's about it. I have a simple request. Now, once I close this session, I would not know who would like to attend or not. So if you are an unlimited student, want to attend, please write me an email. Do me a favor. Please write an email. With the email, we'll have a way of, you know, like a log or a record of it. So write an email if you want to attend it, right? So I know there are a lot of students in here who are unlimited. So if you want to write, for those of you who want to come back and then do this, today was just a basic, very basic introduction. We are going to cover a lot of stuff. There will be heavy scripting, which I will be, showing you in this course. A lot of stuff with Cucumber, a lot of stuff with Capybara. Tomorrow itself, I will be doing data-driven testing. So I will be creating a framework tomorrow itself, show you the data-driven testing. So I will be creating some classes tomorrow. We'll be working with arrays. We'll be working with hashes. The email address that you would be writing us to would be trainingrite@gmail.com. trainingrite@gmail.com. For those of you folks who are thinking of getting into this, I understand taking it as a single course, it's $500, a little bit pricey. So you can get into by taking some of the other packages if you want to, right? There's a 6-course package, 12-course package, whatever. But if you still want to take it like a single course, it is $499. So that's what it is. All right. For the rest of you folks, I'll see you guys tomorrow, same place, same time. Until then, enjoy the rest of your evening, and I'll catch up with you guys tomorrow. Video will be uploaded in about an hour, and if you send me an email within the hour, then I will send you the videos as well. All right, and I'll send you the these files, all of these files. I'll send it to you. So I think just let me know if you really want to attend this. All right. Okay. Have a good night.